normally be a day we gather after spending a Saturday hunting eggs with our children to love on one another and worship and share a family meal afterwards. We miss you and the opportunity to gather today. How great it would be if we could all be on Calvary's campus today celebrating Jesus and his coming from the tomb in victory. Even though we aren't able to be together in the same place today, Colossians 3:16 says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God." We want to encourage you to worship with us this morning and also continue to meet with your life groups. If you aren't connected to one, please let us know. We also want you to keep contacting and catching up with those in our church family, neighbors, and unchurched folks, you know. This morning, we want to show you a video with some familiar Calvary faces, reminding us of the blessing of being part of the body of Christ and the fellowship and common bond we share together in Jesus. It's time to turn up the sound, get your Bible, and be ready to celebrate the risen King.
Thank you. morning, church family, and happy Easter to you from my family to yours, from all those in this worship team that's serving here, whether they're serving in AV or with our praise band or praise team. We want to say to you, happy Easter. We hope that you have a blessed morning and a blessed time, and we come together to worship and celebrate who Jesus is and what he has done. He is risen. He is risen indeed. So I want to encourage you, as you're there in your homes, I want you to turn that volume up on that TV. I want you to stand to your feet, if you will, and let's sing and worship the Lord. Even though it's from afar, we're agreeing together that in Christ alone our hope is found. He is worthy of our worship this morning. So let's lift our voices together in Christ alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, burn through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all.
We can sing, all because of Jesus we can worship and agree together, and because of the work he has done and the work he is doing in us. So this next song we're going to sing together is Forever Reign. May that be our prayer this morning, that the Lord reigns supreme in our hearts, that he does a work in us to where when we're not willing to be obedient and to obey, that God makes us willing and obedient, and we can obey. So let's sing that together, Forever Reign.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me, you
Just like last week, we prayed through a psalm together. This morning, we want to pray through in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 3 through 14 together. So let's pray through this scripture and agree together from what we find there. Blessed are you, God, and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as you chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and we should be blameless before Him. Lord, in love, You predestined us for adoption to Yourself as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will, to the praise of Your glorious grace with which You have blessed us in the Beloved. In Him, in Christ, we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our sins, according to the riches of Your grace which You lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of Your will, according to Your purpose, which You set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in Him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Your Son, our Savior, we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to Your purpose, who works all things according to the counsel of Your will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of His glory. In Christ we also, when we heard the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, and believed in You, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it. To the praise of Your glory, Lord, You are worthy of our all. And You all said this morning, Amen.
Worthy. Daniel Thornton penned these words a long time ago. And he just said, up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to raise. Hallelujah to reign. Hallelujah, he arose. He arose. Hallelujah, Christ Jesus arose. Good morning, Calvary family and friends. I want to add my word of welcome to you on this Easter Sunday morning right there in your homes. In some ways, it saddens me that we're meeting in our homes and not able to gather here at 307 Columbia Avenue at our campus or even out in the parking lot, but I am delighted to be able to greet you via technology and through one of the channels that you're viewing us on this morning. And if you're a guest, I want to add my word of welcome to you as well. We know there's a lot of broadcasts that you could be turning into and tuning into, and we are incredibly blessed that you've chosen to join us this morning for Easter worship. And I'm excited about the word that God has given us. When this COVID crisis got really serious and the governor told us that he was recommending that we not meet, I knew what a discouragement that was going to be. I know that there was a lot of anxiousness and even somewhat fear going around in our country and even with some in our community. And so God led us to Hebrews chapter 12. And so that's where we've been camping the last 3 weeks. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3 the first week, and then verses 3 down through 17 last week. And today I want to invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 18 down through verse 29. And under the leadership of the Holy Spirit, I want to preach on this subject this morning. I want to preach on the subject of God's unshakable kingdom. God's unshakable kingdom. I'm thankful that in the midst of crisis, in the midst of us not being able to meet, in the midst of not tens, not hundreds, not thousands, but tens of thousands of people losing their life here in America and many more around the world, I am thankful right now that Jesus is on his throne, that he is risen, that he's alive, that he is well. And so right there in your homes, I want you to read along with me as we jump into Hebrews 12, beginning in verse 18. The context is that the writer of Hebrews is about to remind the Hebrews who were Jews who were struggling with some of their old Jewish tradition. They had come to faith in Christ, some of them in sincerity, knowing his power, knowing his victory, but also some who did not know the victory of Christ because they were still struggling with the tradition of Judaism. He's going to remind them of what happened on Mount Sinai when God revealed himself to the children of Israel there on Mount Sinai right before he gave Moses the Ten Commandments. And so I want you to read along with me and just see this setting as it is. The Hebrew writer says, "For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, 'I tremble with fear.' But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns from heaven. At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, 'Yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens.'" This phrase, "yet once more," indicates the removal of things that are shaken. That is, things that have been made in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. God's unshakable kingdom. I'm not for sure where you're at in your life right now, in your faith journey, and the circumstances of what's going on in and around your life. I hope that you don't have COVID. I hope that you know the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope that you've not been laid off from your job. I hope you're growing in your faith in the Lord. But if the truth of the matter is today that your world is currently turned upside down, when you lay your head down at night, you do so with some amount of fear and trepidation. You're worried about how things are going to be a month from now, or 2 months from now, or 4 or 5 months from now. I want to speak a good word to you this morning from Hebrews chapter 12. I want us to unfold those verses together and allow the Holy Spirit of God to speak to us through His written word. I'm thankful that God is not silent, that when Jesus rose from the grave, that He speaks, and He is here with us speaking now. Francis Schaeffer coined the phrase, "We have a God, He is here, and He is not silent." And so let's look together today and understand why it is that we should receive Christ, why we should not refuse Jesus and His Word, but why we should gladly and joyfully receive the gospel and to receive the words of Christ and to allow Him to rule our lives and to lead us and to guide us in the life that He has blessed us with. Why should we receive the gospel and not refuse Jesus and His Word? See, the key to understanding this passage that we read today, verses 18 down through 29, is really found in verse 25. It's, if you will, the hinge pin on which this passage turns. When he says in verse 25, the Hebrew writer, "See that you do not refuse him who is speaking." It helps us understand and bridge this gap between the old covenant at Sinai and the new covenant that we have in Christ. This covenant that we have now with Jesus' blood that was shed and his victorious resurrection from the grave versus Abel's first sacrifice of blood when Cain brought an offering that was not nearly as good as Abel because Abel brought an offering that was a blood offering. We want to look at those two differences and understand what is it that God is trying to say to us as he was speaking to those Hebrew Israelites so long ago. And the first thing that I want to say is this. We should receive the gospel and not refuse Jesus and his word because Jesus and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. Jesus and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. A matter of fact, I will go ahead and say on the onset of these first few verses, Jesus is not only greater than Sinai and the law, Jesus is greater than any religion and any prophet who has ever lived, anyone who has ever claimed to have any kind of authority or relationship with the Lord. Jesus and his gospel is greater than any attempt by man or man-made religion. And so he certainly, Jesus and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. Read along with me in verses 18 and 19. He says, "For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them." What this writer does is, and what the Lord's wanting us to see, is a comparison and a contrast in verses 18 down through 21 and how it contrasts in verses 22 down through 24 and then in verse 28. He's comparing and contrasting the new covenant that we have in Christ and this old covenant that God established with Moses on Sinai. And Jesus and his gospel is so much greater than Sinai and the law. One, Jesus, the Hebrew writer reminds us, Jesus is this greater prophet than Moses. We picked that up early, way back in chapters 3, 4, and 5, the Hebrew writer just reminds us how Moses was a great prophet, but Jesus is this greater prophet. He really walks us through all the history of God's children and God's people, and each place that he sees God's work and interaction among men, he draws our attention to Jesus, and he'll say, Jesus is greater. Jesus was a greater prophet than Moses. He is a far superior sacrifice and offering. Jesus is just greater. Preacher, I've got that point. Why don't you move on? I really want you to camp there and think about that thought as we begin to unfold and see this comparison and contrast. Is Jesus greater than anything else that you see and recognize and cherish in your own heart and in your own life? Is Jesus the greatest thing for you and your family? Is Jesus greater than anything that you hope for? Is he the centerpiece of your dreams and your ambition and those things that you long for? Is Jesus at the center of your plans and your purpose for life? Is Jesus the greatest thing in your life? Because he certainly desires to be. He certainly, Jesus was and is greater than Sinai and the law. Here's the reason that is so true. See, Sinai was untouchable and the law was unattainable, but Jesus was completely approachable and extends God's grace as he perfectly fulfills God's law. We'll come back to that in just a minute, but when we say Sinai was untouchable and the law was unattainable, what the Hebrew writer is referring to there is found in Exodus chapter 19. And what he's referring to there is the description of how the Lord began to visit the Israelites when they were wandering in the wilderness and they came to Mount Sinai. And beginning in verse 16 of Exodus 19, I'm going to read that. You can turn there if you would like to, or mark it or write it down in your notes. But here's what Moses says about his encounter with the Lord and the Lord's encounter with the people of Israel there at Mount Sinai. On the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people in the camp trembled. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke, because the Lord had descended on it in fire. That's where the Hebrew writer says, our God is this consuming fire in verse 29. It says that, then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the whole mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. And the Lord came down on Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called to Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. And the Lord said to Moses, go down and warn the people, lest they break through to the Lord to look, and many of them perish. Do you know why Jesus and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law? Because Sinai was untouchable. In many ways, the law of God was unattainable. The law that God is about to give the Israelites to lead them and guide them through their wilderness journey, they were going to constantly fail at living up to that law. A matter of fact, as God's giving Moses the law in chapter 20, and one of the very first commandments is, I think it's commandment 3, thou shalt not make any graven image. Maybe it is commandment 2, thou shalt not make any graven image of me. When he gets down there, he finds that the people of Israel have already began to make graven images of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, it is very important for us to understand the totality of Scripture and understanding how we relate to the law today and why it is that Jesus is completely approachable and he extends God's grace to us as he perfectly fulfills God's law, and how Sinai here is just completely untouchable and how the law was unattainable. See, Paul tells us and teaches us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 6 and 7. He says, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Now if the ministry of death, What is he speaking of there, this ministry of death? He's speaking about the law that was given at Sinai. He says this ministry of death, carved in letters on stone, came with such glory that the Israelites could not gaze at Moses' face because of its glory. Paul calls the Old Covenant the ministry of death. It was written and engraved in stones. It was the ministry of death written into stones at Mount Sinai. Was God there? Yes, God was there. And he was there in an unbelievable outward demonstration of his holiness, of his infinite justice and power and severity, and the terrible side of his majesty that we see in God's holiness and justice and wrath. And there was a man there who was shuddering and cowering. He was turning away from the very presence of God. He was shaking and he was shivering. He found himself, Moses, in the lowest condition of sin and misery and guilt and death. That is the picture of Sinai. And so Jesus and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. What are we to take away from that on Easter Sunday of 2020? I've been calling it COVID Easter, right? Hashtag COVID Easter 2020, because nothing seems like it normally is on our Easter celebration time. But what is it that is the takeaway for you and I today there in our homes? And here's the takeaway. My brothers and sisters, if you are trying to approach God, if you are trying to have a relationship with God based on your morality, based on the law, based on what you do, based on your performance, based on your church attendance, based upon your life group attendance, based upon what ministry you serve in, based upon what you do in your life as far as trying to do good, I want you to understand all of that pales in comparison when stood up against Christ. Christ and his gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. And you see that it's not only greater, but God on Sinai in the presence of Moses, and Moses in the presence of God, God is unapproachable at Sinai. A matter of fact, he's not only unapproachable at Sinai, but through the entire Old Testament and this Mosaic covenant, God presents himself as this God who is unapproachable. What do you mean? The whole sacrificial system spoke of someone intervening between the Israelites and God. This idea of having this personal relationship, this indwelling of the Holy Spirit upon every heart and life, it was just not like that. They looked to their priests, they looked to the sacrificial system, they looked to the tabernacle, they looked to the Holy of Holies, they looked to the temple to be able to gather and to hear from the Lord. It is like this idea that God is shrouding himself and hiding himself. And while he gives the people a glimpse of his glory, the glimpse of his glory that he gives them is a picture of his holiness, his justice, and his wrath. For they could, the Bible says in verses 20 and 21, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. Now, my brothers and sisters, this word is not that Moses stood there in awe. Moses is trembling in fear. He knows that he is in the presence of the Almighty. He knows that there is something about God that is so unattainable for him to understand in his humanity, that if God does not come to Moses in a different way, if he does not come to the Israelites in a different way, if God does not come to you and I and humanity in a greater way, there's this one aspect of God that we're going to know, and we're going to find him most of the time completely unapproachable. However, Jesus is completely approachable, and he extends God's grace as he perfectly fulfills God's law. He seeks. He's coming to town, and he sees Zacchaeus in a tree, and Zacchaeus' heart is overwhelmed. And Jesus invites him and says, "Zacchaeus, come down from there. Today I desire to break bread with you and have a meal with you." And Zacchaeus is this tax collector. He's not the most honest of guys. He's beating people out of money. He is captivated by the authority of Jesus. He immediately comes down from that sycamore tree. And the next thing that you know, he goes to Jesus, into his house, and Jesus begins to speak to Zacchaeus in such a way that Zacchaeus' life is completely changed. And you know Zacchaeus is changed because God doesn't leave him the same. Being in the presence of Jesus changes Zacchaeus, and he begins to make right all that was wrong and how he had taken advantage of people monetarily. And you see this changed life. When this blind man could not come to Jesus, and he was begging for alms and begging for help, begging for his sight, Jesus went to him. When the man with the withered arm could not stretch forth his arm, Jesus commanded him to do the very thing that he could not do all of his life. And in the moment that Jesus came to him and commanded him to stretch forth his arm, this man received power and strength, and he had the ability to reach out and stretch forth his arm. Oh, I am so thankful today that in 1984, Jesus showed himself to me as a God who was completely approachable. A matter of fact, I didn't go to Jesus. Jesus came to me. When I heard the gospel and I was still rejecting the gospel and trying to rationalize away the power that it would have to forgive me of my sin and to truly make me a new person, a new man in God and under God, I am so thankful that Jesus just continued to come to me through His Word, through the presence of His Holy Spirit, and His loving kindness. He led me to repentance, and He showed me that I did not have to come to the God of Sinai, but I could come to the God of gospel, of the gospel, and the God of grace. You say, why is that? Does that not put Jesus at odds with God and Sinai and the law? And it does not at all, because Jesus completely, completely fulfills the law in every jot and tittle. So in every way that you and I fall short, Jesus and His gospel fulfills the law. And when we put our faith and trust in Him, we find that He is greater than Sinai and the law could ever begin to be in our life. I want to commend to you today the gospel life. On this Easter Sunday of 2020, I really want to encourage you and challenge you to consider the gospel life. If religion has failed you, meaning that you've tried religion and your life has not changed, if you have tried to live some life of faith and you've tried to muster up enough energy, but you are living the same life you did before you came to Christ or before you thought you knew Christ, I want to say to you, I would not trust that conversion. But I would call upon the Lord fresh and new, and I would ask Jesus, according to His gospel, to forgive me of my sins and help me to believe in Him. And with the power of the resurrection, that where Jesus came forth from the grave, defeating sin, defeating death, defeating the power of the grave, that resurrection power would be at work in us, changing us from one eternity to another. Jesus and His gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. But here's the next thing I would like for you to look at. Read with me at verses 25, 26, and 27, and notice how Jesus and His gospel save us from the judgment to come. The Bible just simply says this. It says, "See that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns us from heaven." God is faithful to warn us about the judgment that is to come. And what's so wonderful about that is that Jesus and his gospel save us from that judgment that is to come. When he says, see that you do not refuse him who is speaking, this is not only the hinge pin of understanding this text that we're reading this morning. This is really the pivotal question in every one of our hearts and lives every day that we awake. See, this speaks of, do we know God? Do we hear His voice? And do we understand His Word? And have we bowed before the voice of the Lord? Have we received the Word of the Lord? Or at this time, are we refusing Him who is speaking? Pastor Randy, why would anyone in their right mind refuse the Lord when the Lord is speaking? Well, there are lots of reasons people don't respond to the Word of the Lord, the Lord's plan for their life, and they reject the gospel. Sometimes it's inconvenient, or it's a time in their life where they're doing a lot of other things that maybe they enjoy more, and they just think, at this particular time in my life, I'm not hardly ready, but when I get to that place where I'm ready, I'm going to then start living for God. I'm going to then turn my life over to Jesus. And they just work on that delay. Some of the people who hear the gospel, they just dismiss the gospel. They say, what am I really to believe? This is just one more man-made religion, and it just, how am I to trust it over Islam? Or how am I supposed to trust that over Hinduism? Or how am I to trust that over secular humanism? How do I know what the Bible says and what these pastors are proclaiming on Easter Sunday? How do I know that it really is life-changing and it's going to allow me to have a relationship with God, and therefore it's going to save me from not only my sin, but the judgment that is to come? So some people just are confused and they don't know what to believe, and that's why they don't respond to God's Word. Some don't respond to God's Word because they count the cost. They look at God's command. They know what it means to receive Christ. They know what it means that if they ask Jesus to forgive them of their sin and be the Lord of their life, that Jesus is going to give them a brand new life. And they look at that and they say, with that brand new life can come suffering. With that brand new life, as I serve Him, can come persecution. And I just don't know if I'm ready to subject myself and subject my family to persecution or that kind of lifestyle. There are all sorts of reasons, my friends, that people choose not to respond to the voice of the Lord, and therefore they refuse Him who is speaking. But I want to say to you on this Easter Sunday 2020, don't you refuse what you're hearing today. Don't you refuse the voice of the Lord. See, this passage of Scripture that we're reading, this challenge that we hear from this Hebrew preacher, see that you do not refuse Him who is speaking. This is your responsibility in response to hearing the gospel. Preacher, if God is sovereign, what is my responsibility in my faith? What is my responsibility in my salvation? I'll tell you exactly what it is. It is not to refuse Him who speaks. You and I have a responsibility that when God shows Himself and He introduces Himself to us, we have a responsibility to bow before Him and to receive His Word. Could it be that on this Easter 2020, when we are stuck worshiping in our homes and not able to come together and not able to have these big Easter dinners with all of our families and friends and extended family members, could it be that God is wanting us to hear His Word and to respond to His Word and to surrender our hearts and lives to Him fresh and new, or for some of us listening, maybe for the very first time? Oh, my brothers and sisters, see that you do not refuse Him who is speaking. But here's the second thing about that. Jesus and His gospel not only save us from the judgment to come by giving us this faithful warning, but God's judgment will dismantle this world that has rejected Him. It will dismantle, it will tear apart the world that has rejected Him, leaving only His kingdom behind. Verse 26 and 27. At that time, His voice shook the earth. So He's referring back to Sinai. At the time of Sinai, His voice shook the earth. But now He has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but I'll also shake the heavens. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of things that are shaken. See, the Hebrew writer is interpreting for us the very prophecy that was given. He says it indicates the removal of things that are shaken. That is, things that have been made in order that things cannot be shaken, that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. What is he saying? He's saying those things that man has made, those things that we have put faith and trust in, the things that the world has exalted. He said that God is going to shake the world at that great day of consummation when he comes to establish his kingdom here on earth. And he is going to shake the earth in such a way that even the foundations of the earth are rattled. You say, Pastor, do you really believe that? Are you one of those hellfire and brimstone preachers? I tell you today that I believe absolutely in the holiness, justice, and wrath of God. And I also believe that for everyone who hears the gospel, for everyone who rejects Jesus, for everyone who knows that God has presented himself in love and grace, and he offers forgiveness and redemption of sins, for everyone who refuses that, I know without a shadow of a doubt that there will be a recompense to pay, and they will fall under the wrath and judgment of an almighty God. The Bible is clear about that. Listen to what he says, my brothers and sisters. Isaiah 13:13. I will make the heavens tremble, and the earth will be shaken out of its place, and the wrath of the Lord of hosts in that day of his fierce anger. Isaiah, a little bit further over, Isaiah 24, verses 18 through 20. The foundations of the earth will tremble. The earth is utterly broken. The earth is rent asunder, and the earth is violently shaken. The earth staggers like a drunken man. It sways like a hut. Its transgression lies heavy upon it, and it falls, and it will not rise again. Oh, preacher, that's that Old Testament. That's what those people who were living by that law, that's what they get. But I want you to listen to Revelation 6, verses 12 through 17. I looked, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth. The full moon became like blood. The sky vanished like a scroll that is rolled up. And every mountain and island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth and the great men and the generals and the rich and the strong and everyone, slave and free, hid in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains, calling to the mountains and rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand before it?" Oh, my brothers and sisters, there's this great, devastating earthquake that is coming. When all the unbelievers who have rejected the gospel, who have lived for worldly pleasures, who have ignored God, will want to be crushed rather than to face the Lamb of God. Can you possibly understand that today? When you live your life the way that you choose to live it, rather than to live according to God's plan and coming to God in God's way through the shed blood of Jesus Christ and his offering, his atonement, his covering of our sin, when we fail to recognize the whole meaning and the power of his resurrection, will you understand today that when you reject that, your heart will become hardened with each passing day? And if you are found that way on that great day of the Lord's coming, you are going to rather die and be crushed or burnt than to face the Lord and the wrath of the Lamb. My brothers and sisters, do not put off till tomorrow what you can do today. See, the only way to escape this judgment, preacher, if God is love, why is there judgment? Because God is holy, he is completely just, and one of his characteristics is he's also a God of wrath. Here's the best way that I can help you understand that. If some of you got sideways with me, and you wanted to drag me out, we started to fight, and you wanted to smack me, and you started to kick me, and then a mob assembled and did that, I may just take that rather than fight back. But if you were to do that to Levi, or to Jacob, or to Caleb, or to Kerr or to Tracy. I'm not going to stand idly by. You would receive the wrath of this father. You would receive the wrath of this husband. Now, my brothers and sisters, one of God's qualities that goes right along with His holiness and His justice is for everyone who rejects His offering of His Son, you have been found guilty of crucifying Jesus. And God will hold you accountable for that. Preacher, I don't want that. How can I not experience that? And I can tell you the way that you can escape that judgment which is to come is to turn to Christ. Receive His gift that He offered on the cross. The Bible clearly teaches us that God so loved the world that God gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Do you believe that? Do you believe that you can call out to the Lord no matter what your sin is, and that you can be forgiven of your sin? Do you believe Jesus has that power? And if you do, I want to say to you, call upon Him now in that believing faith and allow the grace of God to come and wash your sin away. Jesus and His gospel is greater than Sinai and the law. Jesus and His gospel save us from the judgment to come. And lastly, this morning, as we prepare to close, Jesus and His gospel welcomes us to His unshakable kingdom. In that great day of the Lord, when this earth as we know it is rattled to its foundation, and the only thing that remains is that which God has created and established and has saved and redeemed by His blood. I want you to understand, at that particular time, God welcomes us to His new kingdom. He's already done that for everyone who's been born again. We're just not there in that kingdom in a full sense yet. We're part of the way there, but we're not all of the way there. We are saved, we are sealed, we are forgiven, but God's kingdom is yet to come in all of its fullness. Here, the preacher of Hebrew gives us five characteristics of God's kingdom. I want to give them to you very quick. Brian's going to have them on the screen for us, and I want you to write these down. The first one is this. As God welcomes us through Jesus and His gospel to this unshakable kingdom, what is God's kingdom like? Well, first of all, God's kingdom is the city of the living God. In verse 22, the Hebrew writer says, "But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem." Augustine of Hippo, in his most famous work, his best work, The City of God, I want you to listen as he compares the city of the world to the city of God. You need to understand the context in which Augustine was writing The City of God. Rome, who had been ruling and reigning over the world, the Roman Empire, for almost a millennium. So for almost a thousand years, Rome was leading the world, right? And Rome began to fall from within morally. And then you had the German barbarians who were coming in, and they were beginning to overthrow the Roman Empire. And so there were people who thought that because so many Romans had turned to Christianity, that was the reason that Rome was being overturned. If they would just have continued to worship other gods, that would not have happened. And so Augustine of Hippo writes this famous book, this famous narrative on the city of God. And he compares these two cities, the city of the earth, the city of the world, and then the city of God. I want you to listen to how Augustine puts it. He said, "Accordingly, two cities have been formed by two loves. The earthly city by the love of self, even to the contempt of God. But the heavenly by the love of God, even to the contempt of self. The former, the city of the world, in a word, glories in itself. The latter glories in the Lord. For the one, the city of earth, seeks glory from men. But the greatest glory of the other is God, the witness of our conscience. The one lifts up its head in its own glory, And the other, the city of God, says, thou art my glory, and you are the lifter of my head. In the city of the world, or the city of the earth, the princes and the nations it subdues are ruled by the love of ruling. But in the city of God, the princes and the subjects serve one another in love. The city of the world, while the former take thought of all, the one delights in its own strength, represented in the person of its rulers. But the city of God says to its God, Lord, I will love thee, O Lord, you are my strength. Therefore the wise men of the city of the earth, living according to man, have sought for profit for their own bodies and souls, and those who have known God glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts were darkened, professing themselves to be wise, that is, glorying in their own wisdom and being possessed by pride. They became fools. They changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beasts, and creeping things. For they were either leaders or followers of the people in adoring images, and they worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forevermore. That is Augustine's take on the city of the earth. But in God's city, there is no human wisdom, but only godliness, which offers due worship to the true God and looks for its reward in the society of the saints, of holy angels as well as holy men, that God may be all in all. Pastor, why did you read that long quote? Because God's kingdom, the first characteristic is, it's the city of the living God. All that we experience on earth that is good and honoring and noble is from God. Family, friendships, relationships, the health that we have, anything that we could say that is good, it is noble, that is from God. All that is of the world makes itself known in prideful ambition and selfishness and the glorying of man. But my brothers and sisters, there's a day coming when God establishes His kingdom here on earth, this unshakable kingdom. We're going to find that the entire kingdom is the city of God. But here's the next thing. God's kingdom is the city of the living God. But in verse 22, God's kingdom is the country of celebration. He says, and we are brought to an innumerable group of angels in festal gathering. What is that? Heaven is a place of celebration. God's kingdom is the country of jubilation. It's the country of worship. It's the country of celebration. We are finally, in our unhindered states, able to worship and glorify the Lord and recognize all that He has ever done and all that He is. We are able to do that in splendor and holiness and the righteousness that Christ has afforded us. And we begin to recognize God's kingdom is the country of celebration. There is no more sadness and gloom in heaven. There's no more weeping. There's no more crying in heaven. There's no more death. There's no more night, because Jesus is the very light of that city. All the former things have passed away, but Jesus is this wonderful light that allows us to gather around His throne, and God's kingdom is the country of celebration. Let's not wait until we get to heaven to start celebrating the wonderful Lord right here and now. And then here's the third thing, just quickly. God's kingdom is the church of believers who have been saved by grace through faith and made perfect in Christ. In verse 23, He says, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous that are made perfect. God's kingdom is the church of believers who have been saved by grace through faith and made perfect in Christ. Do you realize, for everyone who's been born again, for everyone who has looked forward to the cross in faith, and they were justified by God's grace according to the faith that He allowed them to demonstrate and have, For everyone who has put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, I want you to understand you're going to be gathered with the church of believers in God's kingdom for all eternity. Preacher, does it really matter for those of you that may be saying, hey, I sort of like this worship at home on Sundays. Let's just keep airing it and let's give people that option. I want you to understand you're missing the wonderful glory and the spiritual work that God does when He brings us all together in this place, not only on the Sabbath day, right? Not only, on the first day of the week, Resurrection Sunday, but He brings us together as a wonderful testimony where we can say we have been born again and we can say Jesus has risen and we are here to celebrate Him. So God's kingdom is this church of believers who have been saved by grace, and then God's kingdom is ruled by the covenant of Christ. Don't miss this in verse 24. It says, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. This word mediator lends itself to executor. Jesus through His blood, Jesus as our advocate. He is this mediator of a covenant that is better than the sacrifice that Abel brought to God. That was a far superior sacrifice than Cain's. My brothers, my sisters, when Jesus shed His blood, there would be no need for any further offering to be brought. He forgives us and He cleanses us and He washes us new by His blood. And then the last thing is simply this. God's kingdom is a communion of eternal worship and gratitude. When He says, therefore let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, He's reminding us that God's kingdom is this place to where we have personal, intimate communion. It's this place of eternal worship and gratitude. And He tells us, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and in awe. Our responsibility in light of God's unshakable kingdom is by realizing Jesus is greater than Sinai, the Mosaic covenant. It's greater than the law, and it's greater than any earthly religion or man-made attempt to approach God. It is to understand that we will stand accountable for hearing the words and whether or not we receive the words of those who are speaking this very word of God. See that you do not refuse Him who is speaking. And lastly, we want to make sure that we understand the glory and the splendor of God's kingdom. God rules and reigns from eternity past to eternity future. How many years is that, Pastor? I'm not for sure. I know eternity can't be measured in time and years and days and minutes and hours like we measure time here. The best way to put it is that eternity, the kingdom of God, is not only unshakable, it's the only thing that will remain and never perish, but that it goes on for all eternity. There's never a time that Jesus is not Lord. There's never a time that His people will be separated because of sin. There's never a time that the kingdom of God, God's unshakable kingdom, is ever shaken again. And may I remind you, when it may appear that the things of this life, diseases, death, rumors of war, earthquakes in unexpected places, when it appears that your life is uncontrollable and that it is shaking to its core, I want you to know you do not have to live there. You can be a part of God's unshakable kingdom. Let's pray about that this morning.
Church family, as we conclude our time together today, I want to thank you. Thank you so much for being faithful to share and give while we can't meet in person. Your faithfulness and giving during the COVID-19 outbreak allows us to keep our national and international missionaries on the field, doctors and nurses to provide strategic help, church planters to continue to be funded, disaster relief teams provided all over the world, our 6 seminaries and students to continue their education and training, our moral and ethical voice to be known with the ERLC, and fund our Calvary ministries and staff here locally. Again, thank you for giving. I want to remind you that giving can be done in the following ways. Give online by going to our website at cbcglasgow.com/giving. Give by writing a check and mailing it to Calvary Baptist Church, 307 Columbia Avenue, Glasgow, Kentucky, 42141, attention Vicki Martin. Or you can drop your offering by tomorrow or this week and place it in the secure mailbox outside the main office entrance underneath the overhang. Again, thank you for how you have continued to faithfully give, pray, and reach out to each other. You are so being a faithful picture of Christ to our community who desperately needs Jesus. Calvary families, again, we want to say we love you and happy Easter. Please pray this week for our church family. Some have been concerned, some have lost loved ones, some are sick, some are serving in essential areas like doctors, nurses, store workers, and all need to be reminded of God's amazing love for us. Also, let us know how we can serve and pray for your family. Be sure if you have the technology, take advantage of meeting with your life group online. Parents with children, be sure to use the Gospel Project online link to share with your kids. Deacons, please be calling your families and seeing what needs we can minister to. Calvary family, remember Jesus is alive. He will see us through this time, this unprecedented time. He keeps us by His power and His grace. See you next week.